In this video, we will discuss the analysis of circuits in which the source voltage or current is time varying. To be specific, sinusoidally time varying sources. You may have heard about the war of the currents. The conflict between Thomas Edison and Nikola Tesla during the 1890s. Which form of electricity should be generated? Alternating current or direct current? Since AC is more efficient and economical to transmit over long distances, AC ended up being the current generated by vast majority of power plants and used by most power distribution systems. When we say AC current or voltage, we're actually referring to a sinusoidally time-varying current or voltage. Circuits driven by sinusoidal current or voltage sources are called AC circuits. Kirchhoff's and Ohm's laws introduced for DC circuits are also applied for AC circuits. We will see how a bit later, but let's introduce the concepts of sinusoids and phasors for the time being. At each point of time, the complex exponential function describes a point in a complex plane with magnitude of C and phase of theta, where theta is equal to omega t plus phi, and phi is the phase. At t equals 0, theta is equal to phi, and as time goes on, we rotate around a circle with radius c, where omega is the speed of rotation. So complex exponential is a function that moves in a circular motion with angular frequency omega. The higher the omega, the higher the rotational speed. From Euler's formula, cosine function is the real part of the complex exponential, while sine is the imaginary part. Notice that the phase determines the point in the circle at which we start the rotation. Changing the value of phi shifts the sinusoid. Suppose we have two sinusoidal voltage signals, V1 with phi equals 0, while V2 has some amount of phase. We notice that the starting point of V2 occurs first in time. Hence, we say V2 leads V1 by phi degrees, or V1 lags V2 by phi. A sinusoid can be expressed in either sine or cosine form. We can visualize sine and cosine as a set of axes, where the horizontal axis represents the magnitude of cosine, while the negative vertical axis represents the magnitude of sine. Positive angles are measured counterclockwise from the horizontal axis. As you can see, negative 90 degrees of phase in the cosine gives the sine, while positive or negative 180 degrees of phase gives the minus sine, and negative 90 degrees from the minus sine gives cosine. So we can represent the sinusoid in the cosine form by adding the right amount of phase. Recall from Euler's formula, cosine is the real part of the complex exponential function and can be expanded to be in that form. This factor is known as the phasor representation of the sinusoid. Phasor is a complex representation of the magnitude and phase of the sinusoid. Phasor represents a vector in the complex plane with magnitude of C and phase of phi. Phasor is equal to the complex exponential when time is 0. You can think of it as the point at which the complex exponential starts to rotate. Phasor can also be represented in a polar form. So to get the phasor domain representation of a sinusoid, first, we express the sinusoid in the form of cosine, so that it can be written as the real part of the complex exponential. Phasor is what's left after taking out the time factor. We express the sinusoid in phasor domain because we know implicitly that the signal is varying sinusoidally with respect to time and varying with constant frequency omega. What's important to know is the radius of rotation and where exactly the rotation began. Phasor is a vector in a complex plane whose angle is the phase of the sinusoid, while the length is taken the value of amplitude. Since phasors are vectors, they can be added and subtracted graphically. The tail of each vector is added on top of the head of the previous one. Each vector has its own magnitude and phase angle. If they are rotating with the same frequency, the resultant would be a vector with constant magnitude and frequency that corresponds to a sinusoid. If they rotate with different frequencies, the resultant would be a vector with variable magnitude and frequency. Its corresponding signal is consisting of all the rotating frequencies of the phasors, so the resultant signal can be represented as a sum of sinusoids. Each has its own magnitude, phase, and rotate with certain frequency. This is the concept of Fourier transform. Any signal can be decomposed into linear combination of sinusoids with different magnitudes, phases, and frequencies. All the sinusoids or phasors contained in a signal are added on top of each other. The tail of each phasor is added on top of the previous one. For instance, this time domain signal can be approximated as a sum of phasors of different magnitudes, phases, and rotate with different frequencies. Phasor domain is also known as frequency domain. In frequency domain, we have two plots, magnitude versus frequency, and phase versus frequency. Each phasor represents a sinusoid oscillating with one single frequency, having some amplitude and some amount of phase. If we have a signal consisting of two sinusoids of different frequencies, in frequency domain, each phasor contained in a signal represents a single point with amplitude and phase. Same thing applies if the signal consisting of any number of sinusoids. So the magnitude and phase spectrum are just a means of representing the magnitude and phases of all the sinusoids or phasors contained in a signal versus the rotating frequency. Once again, this is the concept of Fourier transform. Any signal can be decomposed into linear combination of sinusoids. Each has its own frequency, magnitude, and phase. Differentiating a sinusoid is equivalent to multiplying its phasor by j omega, while integrating a sinusoid is equivalent to dividing the phasor by j omega. If we have a resistor with sinusoidal current passing through it, then the voltage across the resistor is also sinusoidal from Ohm's law. We can easily get the voltage and current in the phasor domain. For the case of resistor, the voltage-current relationship obeys Ohm's law in time domain and phasor domain as well. The voltage across the resistor, as well as the current passing through it, are in phase. They have the same phase. The complex exponential associated with them began at the same point. Hence, they reach their maxima and minima at exactly the same time. For the inductor, if the current passing through it is sinusoidal, the voltage across it is LdI dt. Transforming voltage and current to the phasor form to use the phasor derivative property, then V is equal to j omega Li, and I can be written in a polar form. J is nothing more than a 90 degrees of phase shift. So for the case of inductors, the voltage leads the current by 90 degrees. Unlike resistors, voltage and current in the inductor are 90 degrees out of phase. For the capacitor, assuming the voltage across it is sinusoidal, the current drawn by it is governed by C dV dt, where C is the capacitance. Using the derivative property in the phasor domain, then V is equal to I over j omega C. Minus j means minus 90 degrees of phase shift. So for the case of capacitors, the voltage lags the current by 90 degrees. Now we know the voltage-current relationship in time and phasor domains for resistors, inductors, and capacitors in the case of sinusoidal excitation. That leads us to the concept of impedance. Impedance is the ratio of phasor voltage over phasor current, a frequency-dependent quantity measured in ohms. It represents the opposition that the circuit exhibits to the flow of sinusoidal current. Impedance is a complex quantity with real and imaginary parts. Resistance and reactance. If the reactance is positive, then the impedance is inductive, and if it is negative, the impedance is capacitive. The reciprocal of impedance is called admittance and measured in siemens. The real part of the admittance is the conductance, while the imaginary part is called susceptance. Here we have the impedance versus frequency of 200 ohms resistor, 10 picofarad capacitor, and 100 nanohenry inductor. As we increase the frequency, the impedance of capacitor decrease, while the impedance of inductor increase. Notice that the impedance of resistor doesn't depend on frequency, 200 ohms constant value. So for the sinusoidal voltage source, the source will see different impedance from inductors and capacitors as we change the frequency. We can use logarithmic scale to get a better idea of how the impedance of resistors, inductors, and capacitors change over a very wide range of frequencies. But wait a minute, capacitor is two conducting plates separated by dielectric. How does current pass through that insulating material? How capacitors conduct current? To answer this question, let's take a deeper look at this circuit. A 1 kilo ohm resistance in series with 1 nanofarad capacitor. When driven by 1 volt step voltage source, assuming the capacitor is initially discharged, at first, the voltage across the capacitor is 0, hence there is 1 volt across the resistor, results in 1 milliamps of current. That current charges up the cap, increases the voltage across it, hence decreasing the voltage difference across the resistor, and that in turn decreases the current. Once the cap is fully charged, and the voltage across it reaches that of the source, the voltage difference across the resistor goes to zero, hence the current goes to zero. After that amount of time, that transient time, the capacitor can be replaced by open circuit. That happens due to the fact that at the end the cap is fully charged, reaching the value of the source voltage. To make the current continuously flowing, we must prevent the cap from reaching the source voltage. We can achieve that by using a variable voltage source instead of constant. The voltage across the cap can change instantaneously. It takes some time for the cap to catch up the source voltage. Let's drive the same circuit with sinusoidally time-varying voltage source, while the capacitor is initially discharged with 0 volts across it. As the source voltage change, the voltage across the cap is changing the same way trying to catch it. The cap voltage never reaches the source, except at certain points in time when the source is reversing the direction. These points represent the maxima and minima of the cap voltage. Other than that, there is always voltage difference across the resistor, hence there is always current flowing. That current is also varying sinusoidally with respect to time, depending on the voltage difference across the resistor. When the source voltage is higher than that across the cap, then the current is positive. When the voltage across the cap is higher than the source, the current is negative. It feels like the cap in this case is conducting current, but actually that never happens. There is no current passing through the capacitor. The current is just moving back and forth due to the effect of reversing the voltage difference across the resistor. By current, I mean conduction current. Because there is another kind of current that can pass through the capacitor and an insulator, the displacement current. Displacement current is a concept made by James Maxwell to modify Ampere's law. I talked about that in my Maxwell's equations video. Here's another intuition why the voltage across the capacitor lags the current by 90 degrees. When the voltage in the cap is zero, the voltage difference across the resistor is the full source voltage, hence the current is maximum. And when the voltage across the cap is maximum, the voltage difference is zero, and hence the current is zero. Notice that the maximum voltage in the cap is when it is equal to the source voltage. So when the cap voltage is maximum, the current is zero, and when it is zero, the current is maximum. As you can see, the current is leading the voltage by 90 degrees. As you can see, the output voltage, or the response of the circuit to a sinusoidal input, is also a sinusoid having the same frequency, but with different amplitude and phase. And in general, if we apply a sinusoidal input to any linear time invariant system, the output is also a sinusoid at the same frequency. Changes happen only to the amplitude and phase. Now we introduce the analysis of circuits under sinusoidally time varying excitation. Knowing the response of the circuit to sinusoidal excitation, we can predict the response to any other kind of signal. Because from Fourier analysis, any signal can be broken down into sinusoids with different frequencies that, when added up together, give the original signal. And since most of the circuits we deal with are linear time invariant, the response to any signal is nothing more than a linear combination of sinusoidal responses. For instance, if we apply a step voltage signal to the series resistor and capacitor circuit we saw earlier, the simulator will use the fast Fourier transform to decompose the signal into a set of sinusoids. Each sinusoid has a magnitude and phase and oscillate with certain frequency to represent a single point in the magnitude and phase spectrum. The higher the number of sinusoids to be added, the higher the convergence between the approximated signal and the original one. Here we have the sinusoids constructing the step input signal as well as their amplitudes and phases. Each one of them, when applied to the circuit as input, the output is another sinusoid oscillating with the same frequency but has different amplitude and phase. Since we know the analysis of the circuit under sinusoidal excitation, the simulator will calculate the response of each sinusoid contained in a signal one by one, and the final response is the sum of all the individual responses. Here we have the response of the circuit to each sinusoid contained in a step input signal. When added up together, we get the response of the circuit to the step signal. This circuit is a low-pass filter, by the way. We will discuss filters in future videos. But here we can see that the sinusoids of higher frequencies are attenuated, while attenuation becomes more and more negligible as we move to lower frequencies. So long story short, sinusoids and complex exponentials are the basic building blocks that construct any type of signal. And knowing how to analyze systems driven by a sinusoid enables us to predict the response of the system to any kind of signal.